It's a pleasure to have today with us Professor Subir Sachdev from Harvard University. Hello, Subir.
Hello, Atish. Really pleasure to be here, and Rosario.
And we have with us also the head of our condensed matter physics section, Professor Rosario Fazio. And today we will be discussing with Subir various aspects of his work, the Dirac model, and many other things. So I should just say a few words. Subir has a very distinguished career in condensed matter physics. The 2018 Dirac Medal was awarded, among other things, for his pioneering contributions to the discovery of novel phases of strongly interacting electrons, and also for original transdisciplinary connections, you know, with black hole physics and string theory and so on. So welcome, Subir.
Thank you, Atish.
So let me start perhaps with the recent, there has been recent excitement about your work, you know, inspired by your work, the this famous SYK model, which has now become famous, the Sachdev Ye Kitaye model. And it's a very simple, solvable model, but which also exhibits kind of maximal chaos, a property that it shares with the physics of black holes. So this has been led to a lot of very interesting connection between these otherwise extremely unrelated areas of physics. So maybe can you say a bit about the SYK model? Yes.
Yeah, sure. So originally, you know, way back in 92, 93, I was thinking about the strange metal phase of the cuprate high temperature superconductors. And it was very clear at that time that you needed a description of this phase without using, you know, the quasi-particle method, which is the basis of almost everything in condensed matter physics. And I thought it would be useful to find a toy model which didn't have quasi-particles and also had some kind of metallic behavior. And that was its origin. So absence of quasi-particles means you're talking about a state with complex many-body entanglement. Also was clear at that time that this is a state that would thermalize, would reach thermal equilibrium in the shortest possible time, which we conjectured was around h power over kBT. And so now those ideas have turned out to be also crucial to understanding black hole physics, because you're interested in complex entanglement, which also has very rapid thermalization. And this was, of course, made much more precise by the Maldacena-Schenker-Stanford maximal chaos theorem and connection to out-of-time autocorrelation functions and their connection to gravity. So that's, in my mind, the origin of, you know, the many uses of the SYK model. It just so turns out that complex and chaotic entanglement is the key to the physics of the strange metal and also the physics of black holes. And then having a simple model then allows you to ask many more subtle questions. In particular, you know, Hawking's information paradox is really how information leaks out of an evaporating black hole. And I think, paraphrasing, I mean, the key is that it leaks out not particle by particle, but really in the many-body entanglement state. And with things, and developments going out of the SYK model have enabled people to ask much more sensitive questions on the nature of the entanglement. And at least in some simple situation, this has led to a pretty complete understanding of how Hawking's information paradox has been resolved. So that's been, of course, very gratifying and exciting to see. You know, I had a hunch that this was an important problem back then, but certainly in 93 I never dreamed that it would have the impact it seems to be having now. So that's, of course, been very exciting.
So you mentioned already that the word entanglement, this type of concept, several decades ago belonged to the foundation of quantum mechanics, but now right. seem to play a very yeah. important role in condensed matter. How do you see the meeting of these two fields, condensed matter, quantum information? How important is?
Yeah, so I mean, I think there certainly were developments in condensed matter where people started thinking about fractionalization and how that could lead to new types of many-body states that could not be described by perturbation theory from the free particle picture. And that led to various field theories and connections to gauge theories and deconfinement and gauge theories and Chern-Simons theories. So there's been a fairly self-contained development along those directions. On the other hand, then there was coming from quantum information. There's been ideas on quantum entanglement, entanglement entropies, and different other measures of entanglement. And I think that's given us a much deeper picture on what the structure of these fractionalized phases are. I would say from the condensed matter side, there's the density matrix renormalization group, which is a numerical method to understand these correlated phases, which is very successful, at least in one dimension. And that's closely connected to ideas from quantum information, it turns out, and the fact that, quantum ground states have an area law of entanglement entropy, all of that. And now there's a more unified understanding, and that's had, I think, beneficial effects on both sides. So that's just one example.
But that will play also a role in quantum simulators, and you're also interested in this.
Sure, yeah, quantum simulators also, especially in cold atom systems, give us a way of exploring a regime that you cannot explore by ordinary computers, and also measure in these cold atom systems observables that are not so easy to measure in condensed matter. For example, like the doped Hubbard model, when you're studying the pseudo gap phase, say, or the strained metal phase, the kind of probes you have in cold atoms on these quantum simulators of the same phase of matter compared to the probes you have in condensed matter are very, very different. And that having these two very different classes of probes is giving us, it's, I think, a very powerful way of testing your theoretical ideas. If they can work with both sets of probes, then maybe you're onto something.
Yeah. Yeah, so I think going back to this connection between gravity and condensed matter physics, so this holographic correspondence between string theory and de Sitter space and conformal field theory on the boundary, it has proven to be extremely powerful and very illuminating. People have studied it also for studying strongly coupled gauge theories. And it has led to many interesting qualitative insights, like, for example, an understanding of the chiral symmetry breaking in gauge theories. You are among the first people perhaps going against the opinion in the condensed matter community. I don't know how the condensed matter community views it, to really try to forge this connection. So what were the sort of new insights, or can you elaborate what, if you learned something from the gravity side, which was particularly striking for you? Or
yeah, definitely. I mean, I think it's been a two-way street. Initially, I was thinking about quantum critical points in condensed matter, which are also conformal field theories, some of them anyway, and trying to understand, the transport of charge in a system near such a quantum critical point. This is something that Rosario has also done some very important work on. And it was clear that, you could use in some limits the Boltzmann type approach to compute things, but it wasn't really, it's also clear that that broke down when you really went to the physical region that's accessible. So I was definitely searching for some other method that could address the quantum critical point, other points of view. And in my mind, the you know, the most important property of the critical point was this rapid thermalization, that you had a time of order h bar divided by kBT, which has now been called the Planckian time. So I would have been happy to find any system that had this Planckian time. And that was when I heard about, you know, I was asking various my people, friends in string theory community, you know, what should I be looking at? Is there anything like this? And then I heard about the work of Dam Thanh Son, who has started thinking about the gluon plasma in that language. And the moment I saw his paper, I said, there's Compton Son and started his paper. This is exactly what I'm looking for. This is the kind of, this fits in very nicely with what we need. And so that allowed, you know, the holographic methods have since allowed a much better understanding of the frequency-dependent conductivity right at the critical point in that system. Now that hasn't still been measured in experiment, but hopefully it will be, and you can test some of the holographic predictions there. But it has led, holography has also led to many other insights. For example, another famous problem, which is Planckian, is a strange metal problem, and people address it by, it's in a theory very similar to the quark gluon plasma, where you have a Fermi surface coupled to some gauge fields. In the quark gluon plasma, you have quarks coupled to SU3 gauge fields in three dimensions. In a strange metal, in many models of the strange metal, you would have some fractionalized particles like spinons or holons coupled to a gauge field. And there had been various studies of transport in such systems, and they took a very condensed matter point of view. You have these fermions, they scatter off the gauge bosons, and you put that into some transport picture and you get some transport results. But this is a regime where the fermions and bosons are interacting so strongly that they don't independently exist. There's only some entangled quantum fluid. And so if you look at it in the holographic point of view, you know, you get some results for transport which are totally different in that case than they were from the perturbative Boltzmann perspective. I think I was the first to point out that many of these results were not right, and that in my mind came directly from my experience and understanding of holography. Of course, after the fact, once you've understood that there's a problem, and that's happened several times, then you can go back and address the problem in condensed matter terms, and you don't need holography ultimately, sometimes. You can address the physical problem, but in several cases, it's given very important hints on where you need to look and what's the next step and what's probably not right, because it really talks about dynamical quantum phenomena without using the quasi-particle picture that we always use.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So fundamentally, in situations when you really have strongly coupled, you can gain some really new insight, which you, if you stuck to the quasi-particle picture or weakly coupled, never see, and holography gives this new perspective.
Right. So from my point of view also, there's the real problem of say the Hubbard model or whatever, and then there's a bunch of toy models. There's holography is a toy model, SYK is a toy model, and these are good toy models to have around because they're more generic. A lot of condensed matter physics was just built on the simplest toy models, which are free particles or some integrable models. We want something the exact opposite of those, and that's what you get from holography.
So I read the story, I don't know if you can confirm, an interview in which you start this saying, at some point I end up in a place where I did not want to be, or I did not know it was a conference on string theory. Is it true, or I don't know if it's, no. Or it was just...
I don't want to insult, no, I have been... I mean, I
when did you start?
Or it was just by chance? I did not get it.
I think I remember very clearly when I first realized there was a connection between charged black holes and SYK models. This was at a TASI summer school in Colorado. And there, Hong Liu was talking about charged black holes and spectrum of fermions and its thermodynamic properties of charged black holes in basically in holography using using the ADS CFT correspondence. He was doping, and then he was talking about all the properties. And I'm sure I was the only one in the audience who knew the original SY work, because it had been forgotten. Even I had to remember something that night. Listening to him, I said, this looks so familiar. This is something I have seen before. And yeah, so I wrote a paper right then in 2010 about the SYK model and its connection to charged black holes with ADS2 horizons. I pointed out the entropy and various Green's functions. Everything matched, at least at the the large end level of holography and the large end level of SYK, which are different large ends, but they really matched. I did at the Strings conference that year in Sweden. I think I spent 15 minutes talking about this, and I got zero reaction. And I think at that time, and this was 2010, 2011, the idea that a random spin system could have anything useful to say to string theorists was too much. Of course, then, after Kitaev showed that, this connection I proposed held not only at one at large N level, but even beyond large N. Today, we recognize that as the GT gravity low energy theory of charged black holes. It's fully realized by the SYK model. Then it's become, something that many, many people have worked on. And I think now there's also a clear understanding, what is the use of random models? Random models can be very useful in talking about very chaotic systems, because they allow you to average over the chaos in a much easier way. And this was definitely on my mind, even in 93, that I was studying a random model, not because there was that much randomness in the system, there was some, but because I wanted to talk about this rapidly thermalizing system. It was a trick. which in quantum chaos, in single particle quantum chaos, a well-known trick, that a particle in a billiard has the same statistics as a random matrix. I mean, it wasn't, to me, it didn't seem like such a big step. But I think for string theorists, now that I think they're very much, I hear very similar ideas now being quite common in string theory, I think so.
Yeah, so actually, going back to your comment about, of course, these are very interesting toy models that give you qualitative new insight into problems that otherwise you have no access to. But perhaps one can, if he wants to be really optimistic, you want to go beyond that and try to make it more quantitative. And
yes,
one of the limitations for that is, of course, that holographic picture is valid at large N in the very strongly coupled Atuf parameter, analog of the Atuf parameter limit, which usually normal small condensed matter system is not in that regime. So you are really in a highly curved, highly strongly quantum gravity regime where the classical intuition may not actually be right.
Yeah.
But perhaps, maybe since you also work in quantum simulate, do you think you could achieve large N in some designed systems?
Say you want to really actually study the quark gluon plasma or actually study holography. That's
quark gluon plasma. SU3 is fixed to be 3. You cannot do anything about it. But actually, a friend of mine gave this very interesting analogy, a condensed matter physicist, that when Bethe started to work on one-dimensional Bethe-ons, that's quantum spin chains. Yeah. Everybody sort of said, okay, why are you spending time in one dimension? What is it good for? But of course, we know it had a very rich history. It had many applications. But not only that, nowadays, people can actually design a quantum spin chain in a laboratory with a specific Hamiltonian and actually verify.
Yeah.
So do you think maybe people could design a two-dimensional conformal field theory with large N
I mean, I know that this is too futuristic, but maybe in 25 years,
well, who can
quantum
say,
gravity in lab, in lab.
You know, I think maybe something like the SYK model, perhaps, it could be in the lab in 25 years. But I'm not so sure about, you know, core gluon plasma.
Yeah, not
with SU3 gauge fields. That may be a little harder. But I would maybe make the analogy a little different. You know, Bethe solved something in 1D with only nearest neighbor interactions. And from that exact solution, eventually we had a much more general theory of quantum system in one dimension, Luttinger liquid theory and many other descendants of it. And those are directly applicable to experiments in 1D. And all of that theory would not have come about without the exact solution to confirm various limits. So similarly, one can hope that, you know, I mean, we want to now look at other solvable models and make them more and more realistic. At least that's what I've been working on in the last couple of years. So the SYK model is a model of a strange metal, but it's not a strange metal that I'm going to see in any crystal soon or ever. So let's say, what have we learned from the SYK model? Are there other solvable models that you can make which are much more realistic? So we have a model now, which work with my current students, former student Avishkar Patel, current student Hao Yu Guo, and a postdoc, Ilya Estelis, which is quite realistic. It's got a Fermi surface, it's got, you know, actual collective excitations that you have in real systems. And in that theory, the large end method we view as a kind of a way to solve the theory in a consistent way. You know, I mean, it's, you know, why are we even string theory? Why do they insist on large end? Not because, you know, they like, you know, that the world is large,
yeah,
the world is actually
three. Because you can,
but it's, there's a lot of power to having a systematic approach, because then it gives you, makes sure that you have kept all the, you know, the theory is consistent internally, and then can give you a consistent picture that you can then use in a more general context. So that's kind of where you are. So that gives you, you know, that can give you new relations between different observations, which could be valid in the real world, between the optical conductivity and the DC conductivity. We can get new types of relations, for example, which are exact formally. We can see from the structure of the theory. And all of these kind of exact relations rely very crucially on having some systematic large end point of view. If you want to actually predict a certain number from the microscopics, that'll be hard. We will require a quantum computer, so the combination of some quantum simulations with these kind of methods, maybe that will eventually give us, you know, more powerful predictive machine.
Yeah, because I think the history actually goes in a very random way. I mean, if you look at the Bethean's outside, I mean,
sure,
the applications go in directions that you have not foreseen.
Right.
So.
Yes.
Is it important also to improve experiments, or do you think the level of experimental knowledge is?
There's different experiments. So if you look at experiments in condensed matter in high TC, I think experiments are ahead of theory, and they've really done beautiful experiments. But now it seems to be very helpful to make the crystals even cleaner. They're very clean, but even cleaner. You know, the fractal quantum Hall effect, what made all the discoveries possible was the ability to, was cleaner and cleaner samples. Then you get more and more interesting correlated states. In experiments in the cuprates, I think there's room for improvement in that direction. You know, and people are now moving to higher and higher magnetic fields. They're up to about 60 Tesla. Maybe there'll be next generation of experiments there. They have new probes like the thermal Hall effect. And so the technological improvements on the experimental side since 1987 have been just totally amazing and totally transformed how much we know. Theory is also developed, right? But I think theory is behind experiments. There's no shortage of things that no one can explain, that have been observed in any convincing way. So in cold atoms, yeah, they've gone to fairly big systems, but they're still at relatively high temperatures. You know, if you renormalize the scales, they're on the order of 600 Kelvin, whereas a lot of the interesting things happen at 100 Kelvin or below. So at least an order of magnitude lower in temperature for the fermionic Hubbard model, say. I think that will happen, I mean, given the steady progress in that field. But it's a very exciting time because there's all these developments in experiments, in theory, and also coming, you know, all these influences from other fields. So hopefully, I'll stay active and alive long enough to see more, many more things.
Okay, maybe one last question, maybe changing the topic a little bit. Since I know that you grew up in India, me, and did you study at IIT Delhi or?
For one year.
I was a
freshman there.
Okay, so I studied at IIT Kanpur, and I mean, like many Indians, then you go to the United States and, it's a question sort of related to the mission of ICTP, and you have been the member of our scientific council in the past. What do you see? I'm sure you have also felt yourself to, in what way, being in a diaspora, in what way you can contribute to science in India or in developing countries, and what role an organization, ICTP has this very unique capability and record of doing this. So, if you want to comment on.
There's no question that ICTP has played a very important role in the development of basic science, especially physics, in India. Now, of course, India has come a long way, and there are many world-class institutions in India. But many of those younger people there now have visited ICTP at some point or the other. But I would say there's also, India's a country like India. There's so many other education institutions, various universities where a lot of the undergraduates are taught, and especially for those teachers working at those universities to have opportunity to say maybe visit ICTP for even a month and see what's going on at the frontier and bring that knowledge down, across the country, I think would be very, something would be great to do, and ICTP is doing a great job. So at this point, I think a country like India has come a long way. Maybe it doesn't need ICTP as much, but there are many other countries which ICTP could play the role that it played for India maybe a few decades ago.
No, I think you have put you said it very correctly. At least it resonates with what I myself think, because when I became the director, that I had in what way ICTP's mission can get redefined and I think it's really true that Bhava had this vision to establish high level of scientific institution in India, which of course is the final goal, because you really want each developing country to be scientifically independent, whereas Salam's vision was to have an international hub where scientists from all over the world can come together. And I think these two are still complementary.
Yes.
In a country like India, that, as you said, if you go down to some other universities, it's having a resource like ICTP is important even for India, where you do have a very world-class and mature scientific community. So I think I would agree with you. But, do you see a role for the diaspora or you yourself? How do you, is there some way that we can, there is a huge resource of the scientists in diaspora who are actually keen to contribute to their home countries. So do you have some thoughts on how this could be, connection could be developed?
I'm certainly very keen, and I really feel that I feel an obligation to do that, given the really excellent education I had at a young age in growing up in India. And also I think I now see that in India there's in a way that didn't used to be, I suspect, but a real desire to involve the diaspora. I mean, I'm always welcomed, and people are having all these different approaches and want me to come, and I like to, and I go as much as I can given my other constraints, of course. Yes. I mean, last semester in 2021, partly due to the pandemic, I ended up teaching a course which three institutes in India, most of the time here, but part of the time in India. And that was a great experience.
Maybe ICTP can be a meeting point where this kind of interaction can become easier. I don't know.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Some students
yeah.
can come from India, and some RAS people like you can come to the ICTP. And
right. I mean, this was it required the right facilities, and there was quite a bit of interaction. So it wasn't an advanced, well, it was like a beginning graduate level course, whereas. It took 6 months. I mean, I think ICTP more focuses on more research level schools, and no, I don't know if you can do those remotely. Uh-huh. That their personal interaction may be irreplaceable. But sure, I mean, ICTP already does bring in a lot of people from all over the world, and I do see ICTP as really a crucial role to play in not only the developing world, but just the world at large. I mean, it's a bit unfortunate that it's called theoretical physics, because
yes.
people immediately view it as much more narrow than it is, because I think maybe Salam's vision, which I very much agree, it's a way of spreading the culture of science
exactly.
everywhere. You know,
no, actually,
the culture of science is really crucial, for proper development and growth of economies and democracy. So that's really his bigger role.
I think it's sometimes it's like that CERN also was, it's for nuclear research, but sometimes the name gets, the
right.
brand gets recognized, and then you don't change the name.
Yes.
Salam did try, I think, International Center for Science. I think this idea is on the was on the horizon, but okay.
Right.
So anyway, I think we have come to the good point, the end point. So.
Okay.
It has been a pleasure, Subir, to talk to you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Atish.
Thank you,
Rosario. It's always wonderful to visit here, and thank you for talking to me.